I define myself as a pro-democrat and anti-militarist. I went through those Soviet years that year, this year. Now, I stand politically as that, and I ended up standing more and more politically over the years because, as you might know or might not know, I have been a columnist for Radikal newspaper for nearly 13 years, and I wrote in a magazine called Aktual, and recently I wrote for a short period at the newspaper Taraf. And in my where I'm standing politically now, anti-militarism counts, and it's very, very important for me. And I will try to open it up for you. Where, how did I come to this direction? And I would wish, of course, to brainwash you and take me to where I'm standing, because I think anti-militarism, as a political stand, is very, very important, and more individuals must stand there. And it has to do with being an individual. This is very, very important, which RC gave to me. It allowed me to be this horrific individual, but they allowed me to be the individual. In 1961 and 1962, psychologist Milgram did a very, very important test. It's called obedience test, Milgram's obedience test, in order to write his article called The Perils of Obedience. And I love this title. It explains hundreds of pages, because obedience can be really frightful for others, because it has been observed that after big wars, people say, I did my duty. They told me to do so, and there's nothing wrong with it. Anyway, Milgram was inspired by the trial of Eichmann, because the famous Nazi who was instrumental in getting millions of Jews murdered, he was being tried, and that's what he said. Now I'll find the exact words, wherever it is. Eichmann's defense was he was simply following instructions. This is what people do. They might be killing zillions of people, and they will say that, I did my duty. In that sense, being dutiful can be horrific for other people. And so he designed this experiment, and this is among students of Yale, because he's a Yale professor, mind you. So not random people. So he calls and says, one of you will be the instructor and the other person will be learning. And he claimed that it's an experiment for to measure learning abilities. Then the participant starts giving shocks, electroshocks to the person. Of course, there is no such person inside, but they start giving shocks. There is first slight shock, moderate shock, danger, it drives on a severe shock, and the final two switches were labeled simply with an ominous XXX. After this 300 volt lever, the learner banged on the wall and demanded to be released. Beyond this, the learner became completely silent and refused to answer anymore. The experimenter instructed the participant to treat silence as an incorrect response and deliver a further shock. Most participants asked the experimenter whether they should continue. The experimenter issued a series of commands at this order. Please continue. The experiment requires that you continue. Also, let me interfere here. The experiment requires that you continue. Replace the experiment by army or your nation. The army requires that you continue. Your nation requires that you continue. Imagine like that. It is absolutely essential that you continue. You have no choice. You must go on. At this order, these four instructions in a very calm, scientific way was given to the participant. And these participants are normal people. They are not psychopaths, they are not murderers, they are normal Yale students picked up randomly. Yale students, before the experiments, they predicted only 3% of the participants would deliver the maximum shock. However, 65% of participants delivered the maximum. This is shocking. And at some places, this experiment was made in many places, up to 85% of people delivered the maximum shock. And they were hearing screams and banging on the walls. In mind, afterwards, silence. That person could be in danger, nothing. So people have this incredible inclination for obedience if there is a figure of authority there, if the climate works for it. Milgram indicated that the presence of rebellious peers dramatically reduced obedience levels. This is very, very important. When others refuse, 36 out of 40 refuse to deliver maximum shocks. So if you have rebellious individuals, people will back off. They won't go with this maniacal obedience. Obedience can be really, this word peril, it explains a lot, can be very, very dangerous. And militarism relies on this. You know, an authority figure, a setting, a military setting, asks you to do this. And very normal, very amicable, very nice persons can end up doing horrific things. And this experiment, 50 years later, it was again done at another university, and again, same results came out, so nothing changes. Yeah, 50 years later, Santa Clara University. So this reminded me of, you know, America's Iraqi war, and as you would remember, some horrific pictures came out. A pregnant young woman soldier, Lindy England, her pictures became famous. She was holding a leash to this naked guy who was standing like a dog on his feet. After this torture seances, they took these pictures. And at her court, Lindy England said, "Authority figures really intimidate me. I always aim to please." And she spent many years in prison. She came out, and recently I read an interview with her. She said she doesn't regret it. She did the right thing to the enemy. So for her, it's perfectly okay. And wars start, for instance, America, Bush administration claimed that Iraq has nuclear power, and it came out that it was not true, it was falsified. And wars start, it's justified in one way or another, and it becomes a marshland. After a while, America regretted being in Vietnam, but it took them so many years and so many lives to get out of that marshland. Same with Iraq. It took them so many lives, so much money, so much time to come out of it, and still they are struggling in order to come out of it. And this, after a while, an alienation sets in, and people do not even remember the beginning, the reason of the wars. They try to justify it, because at the beginning a reasoning is given, but somehow after a while, it's false, or it's forgotten, or it's invalid, so they pop up with new justifications as time goes on. This also reminds me of recently a movie came, it's called We Need to Talk About Kevin. It's made from an excellent novel which won a Booker Prize. And then this kid, young kid, goes and he makes a massacre in his school. And he's in prison, his mother goes through a horrible time because she is the mother of this terrific mass murderer. Then when he's when he's coming out of prison, she goes to visit him and says, "Kevin, why did you do this?" And he says, "You know, Mom, at the beginning I had a reason, now I don't even remember that. I think it's true with nations as well. They go to war, after a while they forget the reason, like a mass murderer. They have to come up with new justification, but there is all this propaganda machinery working for nations to justify why they went to war. All these justifications, everything can be broken by the individual, by the disobedient, questioning individual. And very many individuals should stop wars, can stop wars. And this is very, very important also for Turkey. As you know, we are in a war, sort of weird war since 30 years, and at times we have to justify it in this way and another way. But the thing is, blood, you cannot wash blood with blood. You can only wash blood with water. And that is questioning the war. That is questioning the mentality behind the war. Because there are warmongers and they make incredible amounts of money. I have some numbers here. Turkey in 2011 spent $46.6 billion for arms. Holds the 8th position in the world for defense spending. USA, Russia, China, Saudi Arabia spends more than us. So it's an incredible amount of money that we are spending for arms. Incredible amount. We have 800,000 to 1 million soldiers, 275,000 employed officers, 625,000 of them doing their obligatory military service. I have been in a big trouble because I wrote an article, notorious article called Conscientious Objection is a Human Right. I really believe in conscientious objection because, you know, we have a famous Turkish saying, every Turk is a born soldier. No, we are not born soldiers. We are not born orange growers. We are not born tailors or ballets or actors or engineers. So no one is born. Being in the army, being a soldier is a profession. And I think Turkish army should become a professional army. And professionals should fight. And people, democracy, parliamentary should question whether so much money would be spent for arms, whether they should go to fight. So it should be under the control of people, wars, who will fight for whom, and a professional army will only cost $7 billion for Turkey, and we are such a big, huge economy, we can easily afford a professional army, and I'm very professional army for Turkey. Obligatory service is just killing many, many innocent kids, which no one is connected to. They do not know those kids who are getting murdered. No general's son gets murdered in Southeast. So this is a very, very serious thing. We are in this climate, we are in this geography, and we are challenging Syria now. We might go to war. I really, really hope we do not. But it's very, very important us to be individuals and question the politics of our country, to take active place in the politics of our country, and to be very anti-militarist and always think that every kid who dies might have been our kid, our cousin, our best friend. We shouldn't look at them as stock, as just numbers, but as very, very precious human beings. Thank you very much.